Okay, thanks. And that was great. I think you're going to be one of those professors who has, you know, to lecture in gigantic lecture halls because too many students want to hear. You're really good at making things, you know, that are really hard to understand clear. So I thought I would ask a really stupid question about something I've been wondering, because it's not clear to me, which is, if patent laws is all national law, like all of this is done through national law, what determines the nationality of a company? And do different, like if different countries have different laws about what makes, determines the nationality of a company, is nationality something that's, that like a Taiwanese company can manipulate in the way they can manipulate, say, the content of a patent, or is it a constraint that they're stuck with?
Yeah, actually, it's not a silly question at all. It's a really important question. And one of the things that a lot of legal anthropology has been focusing on is the idea of multiple jurisdictions and jurisdiction shopping. So how companies, multinational companies, actually, they establish branches in other companies. So for instance, tax laws. So a lot of companies are registered in the Virgin Islands, and it's not because they actually do any business in the Virgin Islands. They have to open an office there in order to have that registration. But they don't really do business there. The idea is because the tax laws are better, or they have some other benefit for it. It's really fun to look through, okay, I don't know if you guys are thinking this is really fun, but I've been having fun looking through, the Taiwan Stock Exchange has annual reports that companies have to give out. It's the same with the U.S. Stock Exchange for publicly traded companies. And so you can actually see their ownership structure. So the vast majority of Taiwanese companies actually have the company that you know is the Taiwanese branch. It was first founded as a Taiwanese company, and then they established a new company above that that owns that branch 100%. And that company is based in the Virgin Islands or based somewhere else. And part of the reason for that is to help them invest in China. Because of the tax laws, it actually is better if the Virgin Islands company is investing in China rather than the Taiwanese company. So as that concerns patents, infringement is based on the place that the product is sold. So it doesn't matter where the company is from, you can still be sued in the United States for patent infringement. So on that end, it doesn't really matter. On the other end, it matters where you decide to patent it. So some people will patent in the US only. Other people will patent in Taiwan and Japan and the US. So that also has to do with jurisdiction laws. And everyone will patent in the US because the damages are so high. So if you want to catch someone for infringement, you try to sue them in the US because chances are you'll make more money out of it. As for the last part is where a company can register as being owned. I'm not exactly sure about it. To be honest, I'm not really sure what standards you have to meet. I think the main indicator is going to be where you pay taxes. And most Taiwanese companies continue to be Taiwanese companies. Meaning like Honghai. Honghai is maybe one of the best examples of Foxconn. It's maybe one of the best examples of a company that's really shifted to China almost completely. But they still remain a Taiwanese company as far as taxes go. Not all of their China income is taxed in Taiwan because of, like I said, the holding company structure. But they're still Taiwanese, and they've actually started, apparently, from some of the people I've interviewed, they've heard that Honghai has started moving their R&D section back to Taiwan. So a lot of companies in the plastics industry especially are apparently moving away from China now, and also for IP reasons. So I don't know if that really answers it. It's actually a hard question, and it's something that a lot of legal scholars are looking at.
We already have a lot of technology in existence. For example, you know, the combustion engine was invented, developed close to 100 years ago. That type of technology, would it be part of the commons that people, anyone can use, right?
Yeah.
But can anyone creatively, say, go to Botswana, South Africa, and then apply for a patent and says, okay, that's mine. Can anyone do that?
That's a good question, actually, because so the steam engine, as an example, it is definitely in the commons. It's public knowledge. So there's no way that you could get a patent in the United States, at least for the steam engine. And technically, at least based on US and Taiwan law, and I'm not sure about Botswana's law, it's going to depend on the national law, but generally, you can't get a patent on anything that is public knowledge anywhere in the world. So the problem, though, is that a lot of courts, a lot of examiners don't know about knowledge in other places. So this has come up for traditional medicines, in the area of traditional medicine. So in the US, a lot of medicines are patented, and of course they're synthesized in a lab, but the idea is that they're patented in the US because they were new. Of course, if you go to China or you go to India, those are the two main places that this has come up. Those medicines have been around for a very long time and were public knowledge. The problem was that the patent examiner in the US didn't have access to that and didn't know it. The second thing that you could do is you could take a steam engine and modify it. So you make some small, slight improvement to it. And now, with that improvement, you can get a patent on that. So you can't stop people from making the old steam engine, but you can stop them from making the new one. So in that case, then it's very easy to patent relatively old inventions. By making some small adjustment to it, then you can, if that's the only thing on the market, if there's no way to buy the other one, then you have to lower their price anyway.
Just be very curious about your observation over the patent engineer and the lawyers, or the patent lawyers. And what are the major differences that you find, or saying the future observation you're going to, or participant observation, are these could be your major subjects? Or, I mean, I didn't find the particular differences of, I know they have different functions, but what are their major roles in this kind of making patents for the patent engineer and the lawyers?
Yeah. Oh, okay. So a lawyer is actually the person that you would call on to litigate a patent. So if you find somebody who's infringed it, then you're going to call a lawyer to actually do the work, and it probably is a lawyer who specializes in patents, mm-hmm. to do the work in the court for you. A patent engineer is more the writer. You can think of them as the writer of the patent. They're the author, shall we say, of the patent. The other thing that happens when the patent engineer sends the application out, they usually send it through a patent attorney. Because you actually have to, in the US and in Taiwan as well, you have to have a license from the Patent and Trademark Organization, the government organization that examines patents. You have to have a license from them in order to submit applications to them. So the most patent engineers in Taiwan, at least, don't have that license, and so they kind of go through an attorney. And the other reason they go through attorneys is because of English language mistakes. So the idea is that because your patent has to be submitted in English, and the wording is very important. If you have a wrong word, you're going to be, you completely negate the idea of having a patent. So they go through the lawyers, and most Taiwanese companies will hire a law firm in the US to file US patents, in Korea to file Korean patents, and so on. And they'll check the language, and they actually are the ones who directly contact with the patent examiner. So in my participant observation, I'm dealing with mainly patent engineers. There are lawyers in the company I'm working with, but I haven't seen them yet. I don't even know if they're in the same building as me. It's kind of odd. None of the buildings are marked. The doors aren't marked with what they are, so you actually have to know what's on the other side of the door before you put your pass on it to go in to get clicked in. So I actually haven't. I've been there for 3 weeks, and I haven't actually seen the factory yet. I'm working
interesting
on
to see how they see each other. You know.
Yeah.
Your major point is that secrecy, the importance is in the content that I put in the form.